What's up, everybody? I hope you're having a wonderful day and a wonderful week. CHM Carnivores here. And normally when we think about carnivorous plants, we're thinking the big, beautiful Nepenthes. Everybody seems to love the giant truncatas. We're thinking about the enigmatic Venus flytrap and their amazing traps that look otherworldly. But today, I want to talk about a more unassuming carnivorous plant that is equally amazing and packs a real punch. It's going to combine the very, very small with very complex and amazing traps, the fastest in all of carnivory for carnivorous plants. Today, I want to talk to you about Utricularia, and I want to show you what the collection is looking like. It is absolutely amazing. We're going to look at why it's called the orchids of the carnivorous plant world, as many of them are blooming. All that and more coming your way right now. So this is what I was referring to when I talk about Utricularia, and these are known as terrestrial Utricularia. They are different types. There are orchioides, which are going to be much larger in size and are going to be more epiphytic in nature. I personally like the terrestrial Utricularia just because of how insidious they are. They look like you could easily walk right past them and not understand what it is that you're walking over. And a lot of times it almost looks like you're just growing dirt in the pot or some sort of mold that is grown on there. We'll talk about the flowers in just a minute, but there is a whole world that is happening under the soil here that is quite impressive. Utricularia have a trapping mechanism that is the most complex and the fastest of all carnivory, like I said in the introduction. I'm gonna post a picture here to show you what those traps look like. They're also known as bladderworts, which is not a very flattering name, but they get that name because their traps are a bladder trap. And what happens is there's a little tiny trigger hair that is on the trap, and when an insect or a nematode goes by and hits that trap, the trap inhales, grabs the prey, and then pushes out the water. And that is how it works, its trapping mechanism. And what's interesting to note is that process happens so fast that most cameras are not even able to capture it. It happens very, very, very quickly, and its action potential is a ton of energy. And that all happens at a microscopic level. Now, there are different types like Magna, and others that you can see that have very large traps. By very large, I mean you got to give it context. We're talking maybe half a dime in size, and so they're dealing in the world of small. Now let's look at why they get their name for the orchids of the carnivorous plant world. This right here is Cornata, and as you can see, these blooms are probably the size of, I would say, half a dime in size. And so they are very, very diminutive, but they're gorgeous little flowers. This one right here is called Fissida. And as you can see, it's got quite a few scapes that are coming out, and it has this dew or this nectar that gets produced on its stems. And so what's cool about this one is it will produce these very long stems and give you this big flower scape. Not all of them produce multiple flowers like this. You have some down here that produce, this is Unifora, which produces individual flowers. And they all have their own little sort of quirks to them, which is very neat. This one right here, I'll post a picture of it. It is about to flower, but it has not yet. This is pubescens, and it has a very like ghost looking flower, which is interesting to note. And so what we have over here is calcificida, if I got that right. I think I might have messed that up, but it's about to flower, a beautiful flower. But one thing to note about this, and I'm going to talk about this in a later video, is I don't know if you noticed the little, or it's not a later video, and later in this section, I don't know if you noticed the little white spots on here. So we're going to cover that in just a minute on growing these and what you have to look out for. Before I go into what are the pitfalls potentially of growing this, let's talk about why you should have these in your collection and how to grow them. Well, the why is simple. They are very, very tiny. And so as you can see here, I have an entire ecosystem in this just little tub here. So it does not take a lot of room to grow terrestrials, and they grow very, very well. You can feed them, but it's not necessary. If you have rainwater or any sort of pond water, just every now and then put a little cup in there, and that will be enough to sustain them for quite some time. They also will grow, I'm gonna pull over here to the Drosera. You can see here, they'll grow, you'll get them a lot of times as hitchhiker plants, and so they take up no room at all, but they add this other dynamic, this sort of layer of amazingness to the traps, or excuse me, to the plants and to your plantscape. And so that is just a cool thing to see. But let's talk about care. Caring for these things, very, very simple. I use a 50-50 peat and peat moss and perlite. Some of them you can use blasting sand, some of them like that sand, but they will do just fine in a peat and perlite. And as far as watering, for the most part with terrestrials, they like to be very, very wet. Some of them are even semi-aquatic, like Fulva over here. And so what I do is I will fill up this sort of tub here until the water line is above the plants themselves, above the pot line. And then I will let it drain down to probably about 3/4 of the pot as it is now. And then I will fill it up again. And that does a couple things. That mimics what their natural environment is. A lot of these terrestrials will grow on the edges of riverbanks and waterways. And so as it floods, they sort of have that ebb and flow. And they what that will do is that will sort of signal them to start producing flowers. And that's why you see all these flowerscapes here. They can get a little dry, but you don't want to let them dry out. You want to make sure that you fill up the tray, keep the water level high. I recommend a higher tub like this just because it keeps the evaporation a little bit more at bay. But other than that, they do very well. They can handle strong light all the way down to almost a shade, but they like a dappled light. And so you certainly, as you can see here with Drosera, they can handle strong light for sure, but it's not necessary for that. They will handle just about anything from extreme strong light that you need for outdoor growth of Drosera or indoor growth, but they can also handle very dappled light as well. As far as fertilizing them, you don't even need to do that. They take care of themselves. They are probably the easiest of all carnivorous plants to grow. Orchioides are a little bit more difficult, but these terrestrials are extremely, extremely easy to grow. Just to give them lots of water, a good soil mix, and the light can vary quite a bit. As far as humidity, don't worry about it. This grow tent probably has 20% to 30% humidity, and they do just fine. And so that's yet another reason why they are amazing plants to grow. Now let's talk about what are some of the pests that you have to deal with them. So let's talk about some of the pests that you'll have to deal with. The most common pests that you will deal with are, unfortunately, aphids. Now, aphids aren't going to be deadly to these plants, but they will take away the fun of them, and that is the flowerscapes. They love these flowerscapes. And let's see if I can pull here and get it to focus. I don't think it's going to focus that well, but there's little tiny white spots on that, and those are the aphid husk, or their skin, their scales, as they continue to grow. Now, what they'll do with these flowerscapes, let's see if I can find an example of it for you. Here's one right here. Gosh, it is, when you're dealing with such a small, it's such a hard time to see, but essentially it will terminate the flower stalk. So they will go up there and just take all the juices out of the flower stalk. And so you want these beautiful flowers, but they won't actually form. And so it will deform your other plants. So it can cause a lot of deformation in like a Drosera. But with these, you're mainly gonna see, because the stolons are so small, you're mainly gonna see the impact on your flowers, which is a big bummer, because that's why we grow these plants. The other bummer is, what I use is neem oil. Unfortunately, the flower stalks tend to be sensitive to neem oil, and they burn very easily. You can use neem oil on it, and then once you spray it, just go ahead and turn the lights off so that that oil doesn't burn or get into the plant itself and hurt the flower stalks. But for the most part, it's almost unavoidable. You're going to lose some of those flowers. Now, as you can see, the aphids don't get all of them, and some of them push through, but it's just unfortunate, but that's what you normally get. There is a potential for thrips, of course, and that can be treated with neem oil as well. But for the most part, these things aren't too bothered with pests, and they will do just fine. I cannot emphasize enough just how easy these plants are to grow. Most of them are considered the weeds of the carnivorous plant world, and a lot of people will take them out. I personally love to have them grow. I will even purposely, when a lot of people will cringe at this, I will mix them in to my collection because I like the idea of just this whole ecosystem of carnivory. It's very, very neat to me, very fascinating. And so I will add these in all over my collection, which most people will not do, but I enjoy doing it. The one you see in your center screen here is called Longifolia, by the way. And I wanna touch on that one real quick. This one is definitely a weed, if now that we're talking about it. But what's neat about this one is it's extremely, extremely user-friendly. And it will produce very large, probably half dollar size, purple flowers. It can be a little tricky to get them to bloom, but once they start blooming, they are gorgeous. And what's really neat about them is they can handle a very, very wide conditions. Now, you can see here that this is a smaller leaf, and or excuse me, stolon. It's probably 2.5-3 inches long, and that is because it's under bright light. If you get these things a very dappled or shady situation, they can produce leaves up to 1.5 feet or longer, and that is where they get their name, Longifolia. So I'm going to leave off with that. That is a quick care guide for these. There is not much care involved when it comes to these plants, which is why this is such a brief video. I cannot emphasize enough how easy terrestrial utricularias are to grow, and they are sort of the unsung heroes, the plants that don't get their due. And so my phone's having a hard time focusing here, but they don't get their due when it comes to being on people's radar for carnivorous plants, and that is a shame. They produce absolutely amazing flowerscapes, extremely easy to grow, and they grow in a very, very tiny space. So you can easily add them in any collection. The most important thing, again, is keep them wet, give them light of some kind. It can be very dappled to very bright, and just that's it, really. I mean, they're so simple to grow. As far as water, again, distilled, reverse osmosis, or rainwater, all the rules apply there, and you want to give them an inert soil. But other than that, they do just fine. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have any questions about these amazing plants or any other plants, please feel free to leave a comment, and I will be happy to answer any questions that you have. As always, I hope you have a wonderful day and a wonderful week, and I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.